So when you click on the link that I shared, it will bring you to a board. And as Jess walks us through the discussion, and I see somebody's already started, so thank you. Yes, please feel free to outline what you see are the priority systems, leverage points, and references. To add your notes, you can just double click an existing sticky note, add your idea. It'd be great if you included your name and organization so we can attribute it to you later, and then hit save and it'll appear on the board. And then I'll help if anything gets wonky, no worries. I'll be in the background helping to get it reorganized. If you'd like to review the definitions that the team has talked about, those are on frame 2. So you can navigate at the top of the screen. Back to you, Jess.
Great. Okay, so yeah, you can use those sticky points and think about areas of priority for nutrition and its intersecting with climate. And you can be thinking about interventions, activities, technologies, innovation. You can be thinking about social innovation, community cohesion, you know, whatever you think makes sense for, again, how do we ensure that nutrition is not only included when we're thinking about climate mitigation and adaptation, but it's central to it. Often, I mean, I think many of you know climate change is really the climate agenda is really focused on the energy sector, but we know that food systems are critically important. What people are eating, what kind of food people get access to is all significantly impacting. And then leverage points, again, are these areas of places within a system, places within a food system, where action could really lead to transformational change. Maybe it's the type of food that's being grown, the type of subsidy policies that are in place. Maybe it's more about how certain communities, maybe marginalized or disadvantaged communities, can get better access to healthy foods. So be thinking about leverage points where you see there could be more emphasis and more action taken. And of course, keep in mind this idea of, and I'm just talking as you were all typing, but keep in mind this idea of prioritizing people, the people that are underrepresented, people that are marginalized, people that are nutritionally vulnerable. Be thinking about gender, be thinking about social justice, social inclusion, et cetera. So we're seeing some good stuff come in already. So priority systems being insects as alt proteins. I like insects, I like cicadas. I was eating a lot of cicadas here last year in DC. We had the brood X. Got food deserts, particularly in communities of color, underserved communities. That's great. Biofortification is a question. Someone's asking a question about that for priorities. This is great, bringing in some good ideas. And please put your names, if you're comfortable doing that, in your organization, if you want to. You don't have to do that. Great. On leverage points, we see identifying entry points in circular economies for insects. To go back to the insects one. Oh, what happened?
Can somebody just hit undo if you just, did you just delete something?
What just happened?
If anybody just accidentally made a major edit, please hit undo. That's Control Z, or hit the back arrow in the top left.
Oops.
Oh no, okay, well I'll, maybe Daniel, can we throw some blank post-it notes up there to try to capture the ideas?
Yes.
Thank you.
Very strange. And again, if anybody thinks you may have accidentally deleted this, or if everybody listening could please hit the undo button in the top left of your board, it's a back arrow. You can hit that a few times and see if that somebody may have deleted all of these, and we could undo that, please. Please try that.
So where is that undo for those that?
It's in the
top. You can point to it with your cursor, whoever has this history on the screen.
Yeah, I wasn't in it, so I'm not sure. Yeah.
It's the very top left.
Yeah, I didn't do anything it, so it doesn't light up for me. Oh, that's unfortunate. But I think I got some of them. We had food deserts, we had insects. On the priorities, we had biofortification as a question. Now we've got the promotion of nutrient dense and climate resilient crops. These were all the priorities. I didn't really get to the leverage points. We had
Yeah, and Jess, we can also maybe take comments from the group, and I can try to capture
them. If anyone just wants to say, you know, a priority or a leverage point, they think, any thoughts on that? Anyone want to jump in?
I was typing when everything disappeared, so.
Go for it.
Priority system. I don't know if you would call it a system or a leverage point, but targeting our youth with helping them to make healthy food choices while at the same time teaching them how where they choose their food from affects their carbon footprint. So
that's great.
Let's see, several 1890s. Wrote for and received a grant from National 4-H Council to present something called Ag Innovators Experience. And that's basically what it did, going through the carbon cycle process and then teaching them how to choose foods from the different food groups that were sourced locally, that was, you know, using reusable containers rather than disposable containers, all that type of thing, to teach them how to, you know, curb their carbon footprint.
That's great. Thank you. We captured that. Other thoughts coming in? Noel?
I have a question. I don't know exactly how well it's going to fit into this Jamboard structure. Mm-hmm. One of the, it was interesting to me to see the insects come up on this board so quickly. Mm-hmm. We have an interagency insect protein working group. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so it's exciting to see that come up here. I think when we talk about insects, but also when we talk about plant-based proteins and the growth of that whole market, one of the questions we get is, or one of the responses we sometimes get is, we know that especially for children, none of these alternatives can compete with animal-based proteins for nutrition for children. Hmm. And so one of the reasons I joined this group is I thought it would be really useful, it could be potentially useful for this subcommittee to be able to give USAID via BIFAD some guidance on what that balance needs to look like. Mm. You know, for a child's diet, do we really need, you know, in Zambia, 5% of their protein or 50% of their protein to be coming from animals? So, mm-hmm. or is it really none? And we're getting, so what does that look like kind of along the age spectrum for people? And around these different, because there are people who live vegan lives, right? So it doesn't kill you, but maybe it's a confusing space. And since this subcommittee has such strong research expertise, to get to flesh that out a little bit more might be very helpful.
No, that's great. And there is a lot of work happening right now around the, like you said, the various sources of alt proteins. From plant-based to lab-grown to insects and other wild sources. And it is a confusing space, from the health benefits all the way to environmental impacts of some of these foods. And there's a lot of work going on. So that would be a nice synthesis. So maybe there we could put the whole range of alt proteins and their contributions to nutrition throughout the life cycle, and really kind of unpacking the science on that. Does that sound about right?
That sounds great.
Okay. We got a few other things coming in. Wild foods. We've got
foraging. Yes.
Wild foods. We have. I thought I saw forest foods. Things are moving around. Looking. Safety nets for farmers growing nutrient dense crops.
Hi, one. Jess. This is Teresa with the University of Arkansas Pine Bluff.
Hi, Teresa. Good to see you.
You too. I was at a conference last week, and it was pointed out information about precision nutrition and how that nutrition affects a person's particular chronic disease. So when you talk about insects, we have to go in terms of how that nutritional background of an insect can benefit a person with a certain chronic disease when it comes to precision nutrition. So I don't know how we could word that. I know precision nutrition is new for a lot of people. Mm-hmm. That's a terminology not many folks are aware of, but it would be good to see how precision nutrition and things like insects, the nutrition base of insects, can affect people with certain chronic diseases, especially those who are in underserved populations who have those chronic illnesses at a higher rate.
That's great. Yeah, this whole area of precision nutrition is a big priority for NIH now. So that's a great contribution, Teresa.
Hi.
Brenda.
This is Brenda Oppert. I'm with the USDA Agriculture Research Service in Manhattan, Kansas. I'm your insect person.
Yeah.
and there's far more to talk about than I have time. But I'm part of the USDA's Grand Challenges program, and we're about 50 SYs in the ARS that are actually developing insects for specific applications. And so what we're working on is the nutrient profile of insects to improve them for specific applications. Right now we have people working on implementation in poultry feed, implementation in aquaculture. And in the area of human health, we're working in the areas of improving the protein content, improving the fatty acid nutritional profile, and things that can actually help directly and indirectly contribute to human health. So there are a lot of opportunities and far more projects than I can tell you about right now, but be happy to fill you in on that afterwards.
Thanks, Brenda. That's great. So not only insects, but improving the quality of those insects from a nutritional point of view is also
Yeah, I work in the area of genetics, genomics, and so we are, you know, we're at the bottom level looking at those.
Interesting. It's great. I'm seeing a lot of things come in too on promoting nutrient dense, climate resilient crops, ensuring that the nutrient content under a CO2 fertilization effect is trying to understand that better. Investment in nutrient-rich, underdeveloped supply chains and climate-neutral manners. So a lot on, you know, pushing agriculture systems to diversify, be thinking about the nutritional quality of crops being grown, connecting local farmers to local underutilized biodiversity land races. Great. Have a couple of those more local, traditional, underutilized species promotion. That are probably, you know, not only high nutritional quality, but climate resilient, wild foods, some good stuff around there. Increase the focus on ag production, providing lower greenhouse gas emissions intensity.
And then you have this kind of grouping of comments around food waste as well, and reducing food waste.
Anything on maybe to just trigger? Oh, go ahead, Marilyn. don't want to talk too much.
Oh, hi. How
I don't want to dominate the conversation. I'm
sort of new to this type of conversation. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if what I'm going to say is out of place, but what I will say is talk about something I'm very excited about lately. So the note I wrote here is use of herbs as a health benefit and alternative for chemicalized beauty products. Recently, I've gotten awarded an Evans Allen project that will be about basically a demonstration gardening site for preschoolers. But it's born from this idea of a fellow faculty member who has gardening with grandparents who are raising their grandchildren. And they have been growing herbs, one of them being rosemary. And so because I had an opportunity to go to the garden and get some clips of rosemary, I started doing a research and study of what's going on with it and how it can be used. Well, I have experienced hair loss about 6 months ago, almost cut my hair down to about an inch. And because of some health concerns and whatnot, and started using rosemary water. Well, guess what? The hair started growing and stretching out and all of this. And so I just wonder, anyway, so I'm just sharing what I'm excited about and wonder if anyone on this panel has any experience with what I'm talking about.
Well, thanks for that, Marilyn. Yeah, I like the idea of herb gardens, things like that, not only for as far as beauty products and the health impacts of what we put on our skin and on our hair, but also, you know, of course, consuming those herbs. It's all a great area of probably a quite unexplored area in science of really understanding some of these traditional herbs and their impacts. Other thoughts? I know we only have 2 minutes left. We're doing a bit of grouping. We've got lots of good stuff on here.
I have a question.
Yeah, please.
So the way that I think my focus tends to be at the intersection of the agriculture and food systems and climate change, and I don't think about nutrition that much. So my question is, where does nutrition come in, or how can we bring a nutrition lens to some of the broader trends that people like me think about? So if I think about urbanization, that's something that is a huge trend in the development context. Mm-hmm. And there are carbon implications of this urbanization, one of which is the kinds of diets. And so we've gotten at that a little bit, but there's probably others. So, you know, if you think about the intensification of agriculture, you know, and what tends to go along with it is the homogenization of crops. Often what tends to go along with that is clearing forest land. So if you think about the world through that lens, what are the important nutrition questions or nutrition intervention points that you think about in that context? And I guess my question is, what does that mean for the subcommittee's work? What do we need to do so that at the end of the day, that we can integrate the nutrition challenge with these broader climate ag food system trends?
Yeah, no, it's a great point. No, I think, Mario's leading another group, but the whole management of land and what we're growing and with the encroachment of urbanization onto biodiverse spaces is a huge question. And so there's a lot of work being done on what's the best use of what we grow and not go into extensification of land from a nutritional perspective. You know, what would that look like? And that, of course, gets into policy issues around subsidies and things like that. So it is a huge concern. And I think, I mean, you kind of hit it on the head that as countries grow, farms consolidate and concentrate, and you lose that diversity on farms. So it's one of those things that's debated a lot in the ag community, but you know, historically, the agronomists and the nutritionists don't always align on how to best manage landscapes. But I think it's part of the BIFAD work is to try to take from a nutrition perspective what land management should look like and land use should look like without extensifying. If others have ideas on that. How are we doing, Carmen, on time? It looks like we have to close in about 57 seconds.
With land use, I know the USDA, with the workshops, they have been promoting more no-till, like using the hoop houses, as well as water management, and a lot of their programs will pay farmers to use these techniques.
For sure. Yeah. This whole idea of regenerative agriculture in Europe called agroecology, you know, all of these different other alternative ag systems, what would the mosaic of systems look like across the world? And what does that mean for diets and nutrition in feeding 10 billion people, feeding them well? All right, I think we're closing. Thank you, everyone. This was fantastic. Such great range of ideas up here that we'll summarize in the next session as we all merge back into the larger room. Thank you so much.